Hello, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. You can choose the greeting that most appropriately suits the time of day that you are watching this. Welcome to this lesson on neo-Marxism or radical criminology and crime and deviance. This lesson follows on from the lesson that you did on labelling theory and crime and deviance. You will need the lesson notes template, which I will have emailed to you, or it will be on class charts, and you will also find a link to it in Google Docs at the description at the bottom of this video. So, settle in, get yourself comfortable, either print off the lesson note template that you're going to write on by hand, or you could type in them as you go, or if you prefer, you could just have that open in one window, the video here open in another window, and you could just write your notes with a pen and on a piece of paper. It is entirely up to you. Let's begin. Okay, so you're going to start with a little recall task from memory. Try and do this without cheating. What I want you to do is to write down everything you can remember about Marxism and labelling theory in relation to crime and deviance. So what are the key ideas you can remember, any sociologists you can remember, and any criticisms of those theories that you can remember. Jot them down. Don't peek at the next page of your notes booklet, because it has some of the answers there for you. Just see if you can write down what you can remember. Off you go. Okay, so welcome back. You can see on the second page of your lesson notes booklet that there are some bullet point information about traditional Marxism and about labelling theory, so you could check some of your ideas against that. Some of the key sociologists for Marxism are Gordon and Chambliss and Althusser, and some of the key sociologists for labelling theory are Becker and Lemaire and Cicerel. The key thing is that Marxism, as we know, because you've done it in education, you've done it in the families, the whole of society is dominated by class conflict and by the way in which capitalism controls society and oppresses the working class and divides society between the bourgeoisie and the proletariat, so between the owners of the production methods and those who have to work in those industries. And they argue that crime is inevitable in a capitalist society. It is criminogenic because of the inequality that capitalism creates that leads lots of people to crime. Labelling theory does not seek to answer the question, why do people commit crime? It seeks to answer the question, how and why are people labelled, and what is the impact of these labels? So remember, we said that labelling theory sees crime as socially constructed, that crime is, that deviance is constructed because people are labelled in different ways. And there is primary deviance, something that somebody does, which, you know, might be like dodging the fare on the metro or speeding a little bit or doing something a bit daft on a night out, that nobody particularly labels as deviant. Sometimes people do things that are deviant that aren't necessarily detected by other people, and so therefore they're not labelled as such. Whereas secondary deviance, that is when somebody does something and it is labelled murder, rape, grievous bodily harm, something that is labelled by the rest of society, and then that person carries that label with them as their master status. So what we need to see is that Marxism, its focus on capitalism and the criminogenic nature of crime, and the labelling theory, the way in which crime is socially constructed, they come from totally different standpoints on the wider debate about of sociological theory. So Marxism is a structural approach that looks at the way in which the structure of society, so the way in which capitalism creates a situation in which crime takes place. Labelling theory is a social action theory. They don't have a structural approach. They look at how people's identity and how people's reality is subjective and how that is constructed by the way in which people are labelled and the way in which we interact with one another. So they're coming at looking at things from a totally different perspective. The important thing about neo-Marxism, which is the focus of today's lesson, is that neo-Marxism borrows heavily some ideas from Marxism. Obviously, it starts from a Marxist framework, but it also has some ideas that it takes from labelling theory. So neo-Marxism, if something is neo, then it comes from that original theory, it is connected to that original theory, but it has different ways of looking at it and different ways of developing that theory. Okay, so it's neo-Marxist. It has some ideas that come from Marxism, that's where the root of its theory is, but it also comes from other, it borrows ideas and takes ideas and comes from other theories as well, in this case, labelling theory. So, neo-Marxism, or radical criminology as it's sometimes called, which developed in the 1970s and 1980s, takes a bit from a structural approach, a Marxist approach, and a bit from an action approach, labelling. Neo-Marxists, they reject the idea of traditional Marxism, that they reject the idea that people are sort of prisoners of the capitalist system. You see the sort of little diagram here, that the structural approach, you've got this kind of norms and values that are imposed by the structure of capitalism, and people are sort of helpless against that. They don't see people as passive victims. They see that traditional Marxism is too deterministic. They have a more voluntaristic approach, which suggests that people can make a choice. So if people do commit crime, in many cases, what neo-Marxists argue is that they are sort of consciously fighting back against capitalism, or fighting back against oppression, or the place that they find themselves in society. But they also draw on labelling theory to say, well, hang on a minute, the capitalist structure exists in society, and it does have an influence on people, because the power in capitalist society rests with capitalist elite, and it rests with the criminal justice system and the police, and it's these people alongside the media that tend to label certain people in the population, certain groups in society, as more deviant than others. And so one of the criticisms of labelling theory is that labelling theory doesn't take into account the power structures in society and why some people are labelled and some people are not. It just focuses on the fact that people are labelled and then how they respond to it. One of the criticisms of Marxism is that the traditional Marxism is it's too deterministic. It sort of sees everybody as robots who are controlled by this capitalist system. So neo-Marxism says, okay, we understand that there is a capitalist system there that has a big influence on the way society works, but people are not passive. People exist and are able to make choices, and so therefore there's a voluntaristic aspect to that, and they can make choices that respond to the way in which they are labelled, and that crime is framed in a way that supports the capitalist elite. So people are labelled when they are seen as a threat to that, but people respond to those labels, and so there's an interconnection between the structure of society, which is capitalist, and the way in which people are labelled. Okay, so on page 6 of your lesson notes booklet, you have one half of a table that looks like this. So you have some key ideas of neo-Marxism. So these are listed 1 to 7, and these are key ideas that neo-Marxists have. What you then have on the next page are numbered 1 to 7, but not in the same order as the numbers 1 to 7 in the blue table, is you have some studies that support the ideas that are written in blue on the left-hand side of the table. So what I want you to try and do in a moment is I want you to try and pause this, and I want you to try and match up the blue with the red. So all you have to do is write the number of the red bit of information that you think matches up with the information on the left-hand side of the table in blue. So you might say blue number 1 matches with, for example, you might say it's red number 7. So you'd write number 7 in the right-hand column next to the blue number 1. So read each of them, Think about which one you think matches with which. I'll pause this, you have a go, and then we'll come back with the answers. Okay, so here are the answers, so you can check to see which ones you got right and which ones you didn't. Some of them did link up, so 1 and 2 were linked to 1 and 2, but others didn't, like number 7 was linked to number 4, etc. Okay, so what we see here are some of the key sociological studies and ideas behind the neo-Marxist theory. Taylor et al. And their idea of a fully social theory of deviance, we'll be coming to that again later in the lesson, as we will with Stuart Hall's Policing the Crisis and the Moral Panic over Black Mugging, we'll be coming to that at a later point in the lesson also. But you can have a look at this, check that you got them right, you might have to do a few crossings out and a few corrections, and that way you've got some notes about neo-Marxism there with some key ideas and some of the key studies without having to necessarily write a load of information down. In a moment you're going to make some more in-depth notes, but at least you've got a framework to start with there based on these answers in this table here. Alright, so on page 9 of your lesson notebook you should find this table here. You can see that on the left hand column it says what are the key ideas of neo-Marxism, on the right hand column it says what are the key criticisms of neo-Marxism. You've obviously started to get an idea of that anyway because of the little table that you've just filled in, because of what you've listened to during this lesson. And you have also got on page 8, you have got a little summary of neo-Marxist ideas that you can use as well. What I am now going to do is play you a little clip that is an animation that goes into some of the details of neo-Marxism in a little bit more depth. Some of it is just building on what you've already looked at. And what I want you to do when you've finished watching this, or you could do it as you went along if you wanted to pause it, etc., is to fill in that chart. So we want, say, 7 or 8 key ideas of neo-Marxism. We want some key criticisms as well. Try and think about how criticisms can be directly matched to the key ideas. Rather than criticisms be kind of tag-ons generally at the end, if you can have more specific criticisms, that makes evaluation in extended answers, essays, etc., much better if the evaluation is more pointed at a particular key idea or a particular study. So I'm going to play the little clip for you now. Thank you.
We'll be right back.
quite a lot of information that you've been exposed to there in different formats. It's the same information, a lot of it, but just wrapped in different methods of presentation. So what I want you to do in a moment is just to pause me, have a go at filling in that table, so make some notes of your own. You'll see you've got on page 12 to 14 in your lesson notes booklet a much more detailed explanation of Taylor et al.'s fully social theory of deviance. We'll have a look at that in the context of Stuart Hall's Police and the Crisis study as the last part of this lesson. But for now, just look at the information you've seen so far. Use the clip again. You can rewind it and go back to it. You can have a look at your lessons notebook. But just fill in that table that has the key ideas of neo-Marxism on one side and the criticisms on the other. Just so you've put it in your own words and you've got a sense in your own mind of the key ideas of neo-Marxism. Okay, so if you do that now, and then we'll come back and think about a case study by looking at Stuart Hall's Police and the Crisis in a moment. Those of you that do history and sociology at A-level, I tend to record the history lessons at night time when some little people are in bed, but I'm doing the sociology lessons during the daytime. Someone just popped up to say a little message. What are you going to say, Arthur?
Hello, everyone. Keep working hard.
Okay. Say bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay, it's just me now. What we're going to do for the last section of this lesson is to try and see how we take Taylor et al.'s idea of a fully social theory of deviance and how we look at that in the context of a specific case study. And that specific case study that we're going to look at is Stuart Hall's study called Policing the Crisis. So Stuart Hall's study in the early 1970s, instances in the early 1970s of the reporting of mugging, specifically by Afro-Caribbean members of the public. So he called it black mugging, as it was referred to by some in the media. So we see a little bit of labelling theory coming in here, because the media and the police labelled these people as a particular problem and created something of a moral panic around this instance of black mugging, in inverted commas. And what Stuart Hall argues is that actually this had very little to do with the actual act of mugging. You know, people had been mugged or violently assaulted in the past, but it wasn't referred to as mugging. This particular epidemic, again in inverted commas, of mugging was actually said more about the problems in British society at the time, the problems of unemployment, the problems of labour relations, so that what we actually see is really a crisis of capitalism, and the reaction against black muggers and the call for police to crack down on the Afro-Caribbean community in some areas was actually problems of capitalism and the labour relations and the issues of unemployment, etc., and community problems in Britain at that time. It wasn't about black mugging, that was just a distraction, that was just something that the police and the media were labelling as a problem when it wasn't really actually a problem, to distract from the wider problem, which was the crisis of capitalism and the problem that the state was having with the economy. What you should find on the last page of your lesson notes booklet is just a one-page summary of Stuart Hall's ideas. What I want you to do is to have a look at that, and I want you to look at the seven stages of a fully social theory of deviance that Taylor et al. Outline in their study. And what I want you to try and do is to try and look at Stuart Hall's work and go, okay, so what was the wider origins of the deviant act? What was the actual act? What were the immediate origins of it? What was the reaction to it? Try and see how those seven things that Taylor et al. Talk about in their wider social theory of deviance, try and see how you can apply them to the specific study of Stuart Hall in his Policing the Crisis study about black mugging. Okay, so what you should have got a sense there from is the way in which Stuart Hall shows that the moral panic over black mugging was actually an example of both the structure of society, Marxist capitalist structure, and the idea of labelling working together to construct crime, okay? And it's a classic example of a neo-Marxist or a radical criminology approach to crime. So crime is created because of the capitalist system in society, but it's not created just because of that in a very deterministic way, in the way that traditional Marxism would suggest. It is created in a more sophisticated way than that, and we've got to look, as Taylor et al. Argue, at the sort of wider picture of what's going on in society at the time in order to fully understand what's going on and to fully understand why crime is being constructed and presented in the way that it is. Now, one thing that we haven't touched on, or I haven't mentioned, is obviously the criticisms of this. The problem with some of this neo-Marxist theory is that it sort of romanticizes crime. You know, if actually people aren't passive victims of a capitalist system, and that it's a voluntaristic reality out there, and people are choosing to commit crime, then we are saying that what these people are freedom fighters, that these people who commit crime are fighting back against some sort of evil system, in which case that's okay. Well, that kind of ignores the victims of these crimes that the perpetrators will be committing. From a feminist perspective, these neo-Marxist theories almost entirely focus on male crime. So feminists are not particularly interested with a very sort of male stream perspective that neo-Marxists have. Also, if you think back to the stuff you did when you were matching up the red and blue, the work of people like Pierce, for example, who talks about packy bashers and how these people who were committing racially motivated violent crimes were responding to some sort of problems in society to do with labour shortages and unemployment, and that this was some sort of proto-political protest against a capitalist, globalised impact on their society. Well, that sounds to me like, okay, that might be the case, but if you're just going to say that without actually tackling the fact that the racist crimes were wrong, then again, you are kind of almost justifying, or at least allowing the people who are committing the crimes to get off and say, well, the reason that they're being racist and the reason that Asian men are being assaulted is because of these wider political economic issues. And I think that sort of is a bit of a cop-out, really. So that, yes, neo-Marxism builds on Marxist theory. It's probably a bit more sophisticated. It's probably a better Marxist explanation of understanding how crime is constructed in society, but I do think there are still probably some problems with it that we can criticize. So hopefully you have a good understanding now of neo-Marxist theory. So in terms of the theories of crime and deviance, we've done functionalism, Marxism, and subcultural theory. You've now done, in the remote learning lessons, labeling and neo-Marxism. So you've got five sociological theories of crime and deviance. And in the next few weeks, we will move on to look at New Left and New Right, which brings us up to our set of seven key sociological theories of crime and deviance that you need to understand. Okay, should start to be able to see the interlinks between these theories, and also the way in which the theories could criticize one another. I hope you've learned something. I hope you found it useful and engaging. And until next time, stay safe and take care. Bye-bye.